Blackwater Products USA Truck Series, here with Full Throttle Sim Racing. I'm Dean Set the booth. With me tonight, Brad Patterson. Brad, we're at Talladega for 200 miles of action in the Truck Series tonight.
Oh, yes, we are. This is Talladega Super Speedway, 2.66 miles. Pretty much a free-for-all. It's going to be pedal to the metal this entire time. Who's going to be the best drafter? Who's going to take care of their equipment? Who's going to be around at the end of this race? It should be a very interesting race with a lot of team dynamics and a lot of different strategies.
Yeah, it really will be. Lots of team play out here, of course. We'll get into that in a bit. Right now, we'll take a look at the race analysis, as you alluded to here. We got 75 laps, 200 miles here at Talladega Super Speedway. It's a oval with 32 to 34 degree bankings in the corner, and built back in 1969, Brad.
Yeah, it's definitely one of the older tracks on the circuit. It's one of the better tracks. A lot of people look at this track and they think of Daytona, but it has quite a few different characteristics as Daytona, not only just from where the start finish line is located, but also the width of the track.
Yeah, definitely easier to run three wide here at Talladega. It's a pretty smooth track as well, and we should see some three wide action here. We see these guys here at Full Throttle Sim Racing, green flag racers to be sure. We'll be looking for them to early on kind of take it easy and wait it out till the end. And we're looking at the track temp here, 99 degrees, nothing too special there, Brad. Just a pretty standard track conditions for these guys.
Yeah, it really is. I don't think you're really going to have any type of an issue when it comes to, you know, tire wear or anything like that. You know, towards the end of the runs, this is a place where you can get away with doing a two-tire stop. It's not going to be that detrimental to you. The truck should be able to handle fairly well through the entire time. So I expect to see a pretty good race, and, you know, it's going to be a lot of, a lot of following the guy in front of you. Can't beat yourself, you know, especially pit stops are going to be huge tonight.
Yeah, pit road, we're into our keys to the race here. Pit road right on top, Brad. And obviously, here in this league in particular, now we could easily have a wreck here, no doubt about it. But if we do go green, in particular, pit road comes into play. You've got to get in there clean. You've got to get in with a teammate or a friend to draft when you come out with at least three or four of them, you would think. So it's really key. You got to be synchronized, whether you want two tires, four tires, or gas only. It's a lot to think about there when they come to pit stops. You got the big one always at these. There could be a big one. We seen earlier in practice about 15 cars get involved in one wreck, so it easily can wipe out a majority of the field. You must be conscious of that, especially if you're trying to ride around in the back. And teammates, as you were talking about, we've got teams to focus on here. We've got some well-structured teams here at Full Throttle Sim Racing. And, you know, it's anybody's game, but the teams that do it the best, I mean, we've seen in the past, Brad, we've seen Spear Motorsports really be good at these super speedways. And, you know, these guys really know how to do it. They know how to work together, pit together, draft together. Blackwater has had some experience with it. You got Fury. And you got other teams as well, Brad.
Yeah, you do. You got a couple of smaller teams. You got Wreck Havoc Racing. You got Wheeling and Dealing. I mean, ultimately, In this FTSR league, you have six major teams. When I say major, I mean for at least four competitors. You have some that have six on it, but it's really going to come down to how you work within that team, you know, setting up your strategy, working with somebody, because, you know, you can't necessarily win this race by yourself. You're probably going to need somebody pushing you from behind.
Yeah, most definitely you're going to need help out here. You know, we've seen in past races guys like Bernard Persson pushing a teammate to victory, and you know, you had the other team on the outside. I think it was Terry Cooper Jr., maybe Stephen Loomis out there working together. So it's all about teammates here, and we're really looking forward to seeing, you know, Wreck Havoc Racing, Wheeling and Dealing, and see what they can do. That Wheeling and Dealing team, strong team already in the Truck Series, the likes of Zach McDaniel and Russell Chernowski. They've gone ahead and they've signed Bobby Terrell as well. Bobby Terrell, one of the standout performers in this league, was a free agent, believe it or not.
Oh, man, that's an incredible sign. A great driver, obviously going to add a lot of depth to that team, probably add a lot of knowledge. You know, I expect good things to come from that team. You know, not that they were really slouches to begin with, but, I mean, when you add a character like Bobby Terrell to your organization, you know, that's obviously going to help tremendously in the long run.
Can only help. Bobby's so smooth. He knows how to drive these cars, and Bobby may be spending a little less time on setups and more on driving, and he's proven that can be a successful formula out here.
Yeah, and you have, you know, Zach McDaniel, he's been a standout in this series early, you know, been running some really good laps, really good at various tracks. So setup wise, he's always been one of the guys that he's been one of the front runners. So, you know, just put the setup and then the knowledge of Bobby Terrell and whatnot, and, you know, that's going to be a team that, you know, the remainder of the season, it's going to be very difficult.
There's no doubt that it will be. As we take a quick look in on the points standings here, and as you're talking about some of these guys, Bernard Persson leading the points. I actually mixed it up on my little Facebook post there about the broadcast with Brian Helm leading. That was actually the Xfinity Series. Bernard Persson, our leader here, with Bobby Terrell, who we were just talking about, in second place, was a free agent until earlier in the week. Brian Helm sits in third, Casey McMullen Sr., Terry Cooper Jr., Russell Chernowski, David Shilhouse, Zach McDaniel, James Torrey, and Tyler Marble in your top 10 in points. We look in on the board right now, and we can see that looks like Lane Allen up on the top of the board right now.
Yeah, absolutely. And qualifying here is really one of those things that, you know, it's the only time that you're really going to have to really focus on turning a nice, smooth lap is the 81 of Ronnie Royal actually goes to the top of our boards. You can get away with a lot at a lot of tracks, but here it's all about maintaining that momentum, getting a perfectly clean lap in, moving the wheel as little as possible so you don't scrub speed. You know, it's totally different at a super speedway.
It really is. And as qualifying winds down here, we're going to take this time to take a quick commercial break, and we'll come right back and set your starting order.
Coming up to the line, being chased, and it was Braden Johnson.
Unbelievable finish.
It was 1/1000th of a second between them.
Green flag in the air. We are racing in the 2020 24 Hours of Daytona.
They go door to door for the feature race lead here on the last lap of the race. For the race lead in the final corner at Homestead.
Down the back straightaway, three wide again for the race lead. This is unbelievable stuff here tonight.
Loba is going to have to be very deep on the brakes, and he is very deep on the brakes. It's side by side through the corner. This is for the win.
It'll be side by side. Davies low, Ottinger high. To the very inside is Garrett Lowe. Four wide at the stripe.
All he's with here on this outside line, neck and neck. Who's gonna back out? Does anyone back out?
Verstappen starts to squeeze on the inside, and now he'll try and straight line it. Goes under the apron. Drag race to the line. It's so close to call.
Welcome back to the Blackwater Products USA Truck Series here at Talladega Super Speedway, as it looks like qualifying has just about all wrapped up here. It looks like Ronnie Royal will be on the pole tonight, Brad.
That's right. Ronnie Royal takes the pole position with a 55.087. On his outside, you're going to find the 14 of Lane Allen. He turned in a 55.110. Followed by Tracy Powers in that 45, and Jared Carr in the 7 truck. He's going to be in the 4th position. 5th is going to be that 33 of Sherwood Williford, followed by the 6th of Brandon Elder. Terry Cooper Jr., he's going to be in the 7th position. Bernard Person's going to be in the 8th. 9th is going to be Bobby Terrell. 10th position is going to be Brian Conklin.
And in 11th place, well, the 99, Donnie Staubach's on the outside of row number 6, will be Jason Martin. TJ Bartell will start in 13th place. 14th is going to be Brian Bliss, who may not grid, he may not show up to the race, I'm not exactly sure. Kevin Sargent in the 09 will be starting in 15th place. Russell Chernowski will be starting 16th, 17th will be the 19 of Paul Sargent. James Torrey will be on the outside of that row in the 28.
19th, you're going to find the 23 of Brody Hanna. 20th position is going to go to Jeff Bratton. 21st is going to be William Long. And David Shieldhouse is going to be 22nd. He's going to round out the field as far as drivers that decided to take time. We do have a 31-truck field this evening with the likes of Zach McDaniel, Casey McMullen, Matthew Geringer, David Helmsley, Stephen Loomis. All those drivers, along with a few others, decided they weren't going to take time tonight. Probably a strategy deal. Probably wanted to hang out in the back, maybe try to avoid that big one right off the bat. What do you think, Dean?
Oh, there's all kinds of strategy plays here. Some guys like to start at the back. There's definitely a few. I know they did this on purpose. They'll be looking to just avoid wrecks. And, you know, I talk about that a lot, where I'm not sure it's always the wisest of decision unless you're committed to it. You've got to realize your only job is to watch for wrecks and brake for them and avoid them. If you're just riding and sleeping at the wheel, and then you're looking at a wreck in front of you and trying to drive through it, that is not the way to go. I'd rather take my chances in mid-pack or try to get up front.
Yeah, we know this field here. They can easily do a race caution-free. So, you know, hanging out in the back only works if there's that caution. If there's not going to be a caution, and the guys usually race, you know, green and clean here like they do at FTSR Race, and, you know, it might just bite you in the back.
So Ronnie Royal, starting first here, shown on the leaderboard in the 81. He's actually got the wrong number on the car. That's okay, but we'll try and remember that the 32 is Ronnie Royal. So as we see that pace car veer off here, and these guys at Full Throttle Sim Racing are ready to go green flag racing. To just crawl up to the line here. Such a long time at this track from when that pace car pulls off until they get going.
It really is. That's one of the unique things about Talladega. The start-finish line is not in the middle of the tri-oval lake at Daytona. It's actually towards the end of pit road as we catch the green flag.
Yeah, we're down and away, and Ronnie Royal in that 32/81 is out to the lead here. Maybe too much of a lead here. It looks like Lane Allen's going to come the high side here and bridge that gap. So our 1-2 remain 1-2 here. Tracy Powers in third, Carr, Williford, Elder, Cooper, Person, Terrell, and Conklin in the top 10.
Absolutely, as we're going on the backstretch, it seems like the outside line is starting to form up a little bit. As Carr's starting to get a pretty good run going on the backstretch, will he be able to pull in line, pull even with our leader? And we'll see who's going to fight for the lead coming out of turn 4.
coming out of the lead. And we got Jared Carr up high, already made a move here. He's first on the outside lane. That outside lane tonight, we've seen this in other races, particularly with the truck. The outside lane can really work well here, Brad.
Yeah, I generally tend to stay to the outside myself if I'm going to run in this league, and it looks like the 7 of Jared Carr is actually going to lead that lap and cut. They're going to cut straight down to the bottom. They're going to come off that bottom lane.
Yeah, Jared Carr been much improved as of late, maybe the last month or two. Really showing great strides here. Starting to click here at Full Throttle Sim Racing. And here he is at a super speedway, leading his lead.
It looks like that 51 of Brandon Eller's a really aggressive pusher. He was on the back of Carr the entire time. Seems like he's really good at pushing, and he's, I don't know if you're getting a little different a combination where some guys aren't really wanting to really push the issue, you know, especially this early, but he definitely wanted to get to the front as it looks like the 81 of Royal, he's going to jump to the outside, and he's going to challenge for the lead.
Yeah, it seems like we've got different setups out here, Brad. As you can tell, someone like the 51 here, not able to push through the straight here. He's off the bumper a bit, but come around the corner, he jumps right up there on the bumper. So his car is a good handling truck, but not necessarily that fast in the straight. So this is going to be interesting to see how this pulls out. But the 81-32, Ronnie Royal, back in the lead. And a familiar man in Bernard Persson is pushing.
Yeah, and you know what? The other thing we got to take into consideration, if you're on that bottom side, you know, you might have to check out a little bit for the trucks in front of you. You don't, you know, where if you're on the top side, you can kind of run it a little bit wider to kind of keep the RPMs up, keep the speed up, where on the bottom, you kind of get checked down. As we got the 37 of Brian Conklin now, he's looking to lead this lap.
Yeah, that high line really working well there. You see Jason Martin up there pushing that 37. As we ride on board with Jared Carr here, you just have a look at what these guys are dealing with. As you can see, some pretty heavy movement on entry into the corner there, but otherwise, these guys are looking pretty stable out here.
Yeah, that's one of the things that's only going to get worse as this race goes on. The tires are going to wear out a little bit, don't get me wrong. They're not going to be slipping and sliding like they're a short track. But the biggest thing is, as you can see, he's having to feather the throttle. He's really having to get out of the gas because of the guys in front of him. As we get more closer and you get further back in this pack, you're really going to be out of the gas. Sometimes only half throttle, three quarters throttle around this entire track where the guys on the outside, they're able to roll in the throttle, they're able to stay in the throttle, and it kind of gets to be a revolving door at that front of that pace.
You know, as we move through a couple different cars there, Lane Allen, now we're in Sherwood Williford's car, you can just see as you move back in this pack how much the visuals change. You've got trucks in front of you wavering around. You're a little more blind to the upcoming corner. Things get trickier and trickier as you get heavier and heavier traffic.
Absolutely, and you really have to watch out for it. As we just saw Powers going through turn one and two there, he's running about a half a lane up from the truck in front of him. And you know what that is? That's the fact that these trucks have to worry about getting air to that radiator. They got to worry about not overheating that truck. So the further you get back, the less air that you're getting in the front of that truck. And you're going to have to make a little bit of air, you know, go a little bit to the outside to make sure you get some air on the front end of that truck and get that radiator to cool off. As you hear the amount of time that they're actually out of the throttle because they close in on the back of these trucks so quickly.
A lot of different finer aspects to the racing here in the super speedway. You know, you got that temperature you're talking about. You really can't just push full out. There's a fine line, you know. And here at FTSR, we got some of the best in the business. Like, none better than Bernard Persson up here. He's currently pushing. I think that's Brian Conklin, our leader right now. And he does a fantastic job of getting up there. Well, he's actually two back. That would be the 81 Armani Royals up there. But Bernard Persson, just a master of getting up on a bumper and staying just enough off it where he can continue that push all the way around the track for several laps without overheating. You see a lot of these rookies, Brad, and newcomers to super speedway racing, they'll come up and bump you. You jump up, you know, way up the track or what, like further along the track. You get this big, great boost of speed. But then you got no draft and you just fall back again. It's a big accordion thing, and it really doesn't work that well.
Yeah, I mean, that's something that you can really tell the difference between the people that know super speedway racing and the guys that they think that they're fast. I mean, you get a lot of guys out here. They can push, they can work, but they're never going to win, and not necessarily ever going to win, but they don't realize the finesse of super speedway racing. You know, when you can back off, you can push down every straightaway, no problem whatsoever. When you get to that corner, you just kind of burp the throttle just a little bit, let that car get a couple feet ahead of you, kind of poke the nose out. And it's as much a team aspect as the guy in front of you has to know what you're doing, because generally when they do, they'll give you a little bit of, you know, they'll give you a half a lane on the bottom to keep your nose down there to get the air to it. And you really work in a tandem, and you can run the entire race nose to tail like that and not lose any speed doing so. But it's a combined effort, and you know, you've really got to be on the same page. And the guys that know how to do it, they'll just take advantage of it, and the guys that don't, they just never will.
Oh, and you can see something is going on here. As I was on board with Brian Conklin, and we were looking back, and it looked like someone was right inside of his car. That was a strange effect of my racing.
Yeah, that's just how much Ronnie Royal in that 81's pushing that 37. You know, he's trying to get every bit of it. He does not want to go any further back. As you got the 7 of Jared Carr to the outside, the 9 of Jason Martin, he's up front really pushing. So you got a couple of guys that this season they haven't really necessarily been running up front, but they're definitely up front right now. And you know what? That's what plate tracks and super speedways are going to do. You're going to have guys that don't generally run well in the, you know, the cookie cutter tracks and whatnot, and they're going to be sitting there. They're going to be pushing it because this might be their one or two opportunities a year to really get a victory.
Well, it's possible. A lot of great drivers here, but you're right. I mean, everybody knows that first time winners come at super speedways, and sometimes they're only win, like a Austin Dillon, real NASCAR. But right now we got Jared Carr leading the way, and he's part of that Wreck Havoc racing over there, Brad. You know, those guys, a pretty newly formed team, starting to make some strides here.
Yeah, they really are, and you know what? They're kind of spread throughout the field, so they don't really have the numbers, if you will, right now. As far as, you know, being close to each other, I mean, you got Jared Carr in front. The next closest driver you got is going to be the 45 of Tracy Powers and the 55 of Jeff Bratton. They're currently in 11th and 12th. So it's going to be interesting as this race goes on, and we get some laps on. You know, we're on lap 10 now, but these guys, don't get me wrong, in about 10 laps, you're going to start thinking pit stops. You know, you're going to see everybody try to get to the bottom. You're going to see everybody try to get with their teammates. You know, this is a race that can be done on one stop. So, you know, strategy is going to be key, getting on pit road, getting off pit road clean, getting on and off pit road with other members of your team, as the 37 is going to put that 81 in the sucker's hole, if you will. If he can get by him, he'll be good. If not, he's going to end up on the outside and not have a hope going into one.
Yes, it goes three wide to the stripe here. This could be interesting. Going down into turn one, and it looks like Conklin's still trying to fit in there. He's going to find his way in line.
Yeah, what it's going to do, though, it's going to leave Brian Bliss all outside, all by himself. Hopefully, he's going to be able to find himself a hole going on the backstretch, but it doesn't look like it. Looks like they're going to fill that gap as we got another truck. It looks like James Torrey further back in the field. He's thinking about going to that third line and trying to see if he can make up some time.
Yeah, we got a couple of guys up there. I know Brian Bliss really likes the high side, but if you don't have any help up that high, perhaps he's just falling back to the back here. He's had enough of this early racing, and he's thinking, you know what, they're probably going to wreck at some point. I'm going to go back here and take it easy.
Yeah, once you get kind of strung out like there, you can sit there and you can battle it and you can fight it, or you can just say, you know what, now's the time. I'm just going to go to the back. It's going to change my strategy, regroup a little bit. And that's kind of what's happening. As you see, the field's getting a little strung out. Nobody's really losing touch with the leaders yet, but it's definitely getting a little bit more strung out. You know, you got some people like the 43 of David Hensley. It seems like he's again 3 seconds off the back, but at the same time, that's 3 seconds for this entire field. Nobody's lost the draft.
That's the 81-32 there of Ronnie Royal has taken the lead again, and he's looking strong out here. Part of that that Team Spear over there, who's missing someone. They're missing Mr. Spear himself, Jason Spear, not pretty tonight. A little bit surprising there, but.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's a key member to their team, obviously. obviously the leader of that team, but you know, he's going to try to do everything he can to put that truck out front and really show the power that Team Spear has. And so far they're really putting it out. They're doing a great job. You know, they're kind of spread out throughout the field as well, but they're definitely all within contention.
So you see Jason Martin on the high side really pushing Brian Conklin there, doing a great job of it. I mean, that's real tricky there through the corner to stay that close, a little bit off the center of the bumper there. He's doing a great job.
Yeah, absolutely. Jason Martin, he's a member of the Fury Motorsports team. He's got himself, Brody Hanna, Will Long, James Torrey, and TJ Bartel. They're obviously going to be looking at some point in time to hook up, especially when as we get closer to these pit stops. So you're going to start seeing it. You're going to see some guys start dropping out. You know, they might drop out of line, and you know, you think, oh, what's happening? They're just going back to get with their teammates in order to make these pit stops really work for them, because you know, it's going to be a team race before too long.
Oh, it really will. As we're in lap 14 of 75, now these trucks can do, I don't know, maybe 35 laps, Brad. So I don't know if they can make it halfway. I'm thinking they can go about 37, like right at halfway.
Yeah, it's close, and it all depends. You know, these guys up front, you know, the 81, the 37, they're not making it halfway. Now, you get a little bit further back in the field and whatnot, maybe with the likes of, like, Bobby Terrell, Terry Cooper Jr., Zach McDaniels running 15th, 16th. You know, they're probably running three-quarters throttle, half throttle around this track because they can't really go anywhere. That's when you start talking about the, can I gain another lap or two and kind of stretch it, but for the most part, we know for a fact these guys are going to have to stop at least once. Somebody's probably going to have to stop twice.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see. It's not usual that we would have guys having to stop twice where others could do once. So really curious to see how this fuel mileage plays out here as we see Bernard Persson make a move to the high side. Slip in front of Jared Carr there. He's looking to take the lead here. He's had enough of riding around behind Ronnie Roy.
And sometimes some of the best defense is a little bit of offense. And you know what? If you can sit there, and it gets really frustrating being a guy who's kind of deep in this field and whatnot, is he's going to pull even with his leaders. And I think he's actually going to lead this lap.
Yeah, that outside line out of four, really strong there. And he's going to take that lead. Not enough to drop to the inside. I'm not sure he really wants to anyway.
Nah, I'd be content with just riding on the outside. You got plenty of air. You got, it's a safer position, if you will. You're not checking up. You know, you're not rolling in the throttle, getting on the brake, keep out of the guy in front of you. You're able to just maintain throttle position and go. And you know, as long as you got somebody behind you that you trust, which obviously he believes in the 7 of Jared Carr and the 37 of Brian Conklin, I think he'll stay to the outside unless he gets to the point where he's just out front to the point where you just got to drop down.
No real surprise here at Full Throttle Sim Racing. We're through 16 laps now, and we're still under green here, Brad. You know, this has just become standard procedure here at Full Throttle Sim Racing.
Yeah, it really has. I mean, these guys are really professional about it. You know, they're really going to keep their wits about them. They're not going to wreck people just for the heck of it. They're not going to retaliate to people. I mean, that's what kids do. Unfortunately, that doesn't necessarily happen with the pros right now. But, you know, this is something that we're going to take very serious, and these guys take it very serious. They're going to race with professionalism. They're going to keep it clean.
Continue to see Ronnie Royal leading the way. The 51 of Brandon Elder right there on his bumper. And on the outside, you got Carr and Persson pushing each other with Conklin and Allen back there in those third slots.
Yeah, this is kind of the calm before the storm, if you will. These guys, I think, they're just settling in right now. They're seeing what they got. You're not seeing a whole lot of pushing. You're seeing a lot of maintaining right now. And I think you're going to continue to see that. You're going to see a couple of guys start falling a little bit to the back again to get to their teammates as we're on lap 18. So we got about 12 to 15 laps before this next set of pit stops. But believe me, these guys are already trying to set it up. Two tires. So they're going to take four tires. What lap do they want to come in at the very last part? Well, if they do that, there's liable to have 40 cars on pit road together, and you don't want that. So do you want to come in a lap early as you see the 9 of Jason Martin make his way to the inside? That outside line's starting to dwindle because the guys want to be on the bottom.
and it's starting to filter down. Perhaps some pit stops coming soon. I don't believe so, but you know, we've seen Bernard Persson finally come down and take the lead there. But I'm interested in a guy in the 51 here, a Brandon Elder. We were talking about him earlier in the race, saying he could push through the corners and really right there with a good hand of the truck, but he couldn't really keep up on the straights quite as good. That seems to be changing, Brad. Is this just the case of tire pressure is coming up, maybe getting that truck up off the ground, maybe he was dragging a bit?
It's possible. Some of it too could be a learning assessment. I mean, there's a lot of things where you would think sitting right behind a truck and at 6 o'clock that, you know, not having any air on you, it would allow you to pull and suck up to that truck a lot better. But, you know, that's not necessarily the case. Sometimes being a kind of a fender off center will actually help you pull up to the truck a little bit quicker. And then at the same time, you know, first lap of the race, first couple of laps, maybe you don't want to push it. Maybe it's a matter of comfort, and he's finally got, you know, to where he feels comfortable in the truck, feels comfortable in the race. So, you know, it could be a matter of everything. Is, you know what, I'll tell you who's not worried about it is that 7, Jared Karnes. He's pushing for the lead, and again, he's got that 37 on the back bumper.
Yeah, Brian Conklin looking strong. Jared Karnes, what better? Looking to retake the lead here on the outside. You know, looking at this top group of, say, 8 or 10 cars, there's only really two teammates that, I mean, I spotted right off anyway, and that's Blackwater Motorsports, and you got the 51 of Brandon Elder and Lane Allen in there. Lane Allen obviously being very cautious here, leaving about a car length between him and Brandon Elder. Probably a smart move at this point in the race.
I'm also showing, let's see who we got up there. We got Ronnie Royal up there. We got Bernard Persson. You know, all of them are really putting in a fantastic job. They're really working well together. It seems like you're getting a little bit of Schillhouse up top, McDaniel and Whelan and Dillon. You know, those guys are starting to come together on the high side. It's going to be very interesting. I mean, again, you got everybody still together. Let's see, 2.5 seconds over 31 trucks. So nobody's really falling off the pace. Everybody's staying there, keeping it honest. And I think everybody right now is just waiting for that pit stop, because that's going to change it. We're gonna have some chaos on that pit stop.
Yeah, we talk about a lot up here. You know, these races really don't start until after those first pit stops, especially if they're under green, Brad. You got to get down there clean, you know, in traffic. Maybe 20 cars coming down pit road, can't hit anybody, can't speed, got to get in with teammates, get those changes done, get off pit road perfect. So much goes on, it often brings this whole group into two or maybe even three different groups.
Yeah, I mean, right now we're still nose to tail 31 cars. You know, if we have green flag pit stops, I expect to lose at least 10 to 12 of those cars right off the bat. Right off the bat, as far as we're at. They may be able to catch up, they might not be. It's just going to be a matter of, if you're going to get separation, you're going to get guys having to slow down to get to a partner, you're going to get all of those things, and you're going to ultimately have people lose the draft. So the pit stop is the key. Coming out with a partner is the key. You know, when you do it, you know, not locking up the tires, you know, having a backup in your pit stop, you know, losing that 1 second can cost you a ton on the track, especially in this situation. So you really have to be key.
How many times have we seen it this year in this truck series? Not even on a super speedway, but pit road costing people the races. We started the year with John Adams losing the race on pit road, making an error, had to come in. We've seen Zach McDaniel lose it on pit road, same exact thing. We've seen Schillhouse lose it on pit road. I mean, pit road is big, especially when you're a green flag running, you know, league.
Yeah, exactly. And you know what? The worst thing you could do on a super speedway is be aggressive on your pit entry. You know, every other place, you know, cookie cutter tracks, a mile and a half, you try to get every single thing you can coming to pit road. On a super speedway, you have the draft. It's a great equalizer. You can come out 100 yards behind somebody and you can close it. The last thing you want to do is go too fast, do a speeding penalty, or miss your box on a super speedway, because that could be the end of you.
Absolutely. We've seen guys hit the cone from excessive speeding. We've seen guys lock them up, turn the car into the wall. We've seen them take out other cars because they're going too fast, too long. It's very tricky. And, you know, they come out here and practice day after day after day. Practice this draft, running the teammates. Some of them just forget to practice getting off pit road.
Yeah, it's the one thing that everybody thinks about, but nobody actually does. And you know what? Talladega is one of the largest tracks on the entire circuit. You know, it's got one of the largest diameters, largest pit road area, runoff area, if you will. But you know what? It comes at you really fast, you know. And next thing you know, you're on top of that cone. You're locking them up. The back end wants to come around because you got a little too much rear brake into it. And you're bouncing off the inside wall, and your race is over.
We jump in with Tyler Marble here off the nose of him as he looks forward to his father, Jeff Marble, and the Marbles hanging around back here, just waiting for their time to do something. They're sitting in about, I think they're in about 10th and 11th, something like that.
Yeah, 10th and 11th, respectively, and that's a perfect example. You know, they're going to stay together, they're going to be together, they know what they're doing. As we're getting ready to complete lap 26. Now is when you're starting to worry about it if you're these guys when it comes to pit road. You got guys on the outside, guys on the inside. The guys on the inside decide that they're going to run it till it's dry. How are you going to get to pit road? You know, you can't exactly come from the outside and just cut across people's noses. So you've really got to start thinking and strategizing about this. This inside lane's going to get really long, really fast.
Yeah, it really is. I mean, we're looking at, if they're not pitting now, we're probably looking at lap 37, 38 before they start. I'm thinking that's where we're going to end up here. But these guys doing a great job here. Nothing unexpected here at all. As you're right, that inside lane continues to form up. So it's hard to imagine they would do it this early in the run unless they're considering pitting right shortly.
Yeah, and the only thing that you got to think about is if you know you're not going to be able to do it in one stop, you know, come a couple laps earlier. As long as you got your teammates around you, as long as you got a good team around you, you know that you can get on pit road clean, you can get off pit road clean. You might even actually make up some time because you'll be able to ride in the back with the entire field when they catch up to you and actually make up a little bit of time on them. But it's such a gamble because you can win it and you can lose it by making a pit road strategy here, because if a caution comes out, you can easily get trapped a lap down.
Taking a look back here a bit in the back end of the field, back in 28th spot, Casey McMullen right in front of him, Brody Hanna, you got Loomis back here, the Sergeants are back here, Will Long's up there. These guys playing strategy back at the back of the pack here, and you know, often it'll pay off, but sometimes it won't. So we're going to be interested to see where these guys finish up tonight.
Yeah, the nice thing is this track, you know, you can easily run three wide. They can make up some time if they really wanted to. Look at the outside right now. It's barren. You know, we got maybe, what, 8 trucks in total through the entire field sitting on that outside. So everybody's thinking about that pit stop, and that's what everybody's really going to be worried about. So as you can see, I mean, the field is telling you pit stops are coming, and they're coming soon.
I continue to watch the 12 of Will Long there with Brody Hanna pushing them, and they've had enough of riding around apparently, because they're going on the outside and they're just going by everybody at this point.
And if everybody's going to go to the bottom, I'm going to go to the top, and I'm going to make up as many positions as I can and hope that I can find a hole, you know, and I find a hole 15 spots ahead of where I was. That's a good move.
Yeah, it seems like an easy pickup here. They've already made up a good 10 spots at least.
Well, they both of them kind of rode in the back this entire time, so you never know. They may have an extra lap or two in them that everybody else doesn't because of the fact that they've been kind of strategizing and riding in the back and trying to save a little bit of fuel.
Yeah, that was quite amazing to watch here as they now fall in about, I think that's like 5th and 6th on the outside line here. Pretty impressive. And it looks like the few other guys, like Casey McMullen and that, are following suit here, as the whole let's be safe at the back has been thrown out the window, and we're side-by-side racing.
Yeah, again, this is one of those spots where at the bottom line, it's so congested with trucks, you know, you're having guys having to check up through all the corners, again, running three-quarters, half throttle on the straights. The guys on the outside, they can just close distance like anything because they're able to put the pedal to the metal, kind of hook up with each other and push to the front. And you know, maybe it is a situation where the guys have been riding around in the back, they got a little bit of extra fuel, they know these guys up front are going to have to pit a lap or two before them, it's no harm, no foul. They know the entire inside line is going to kind of peel off before them. They can go right to the bottom, and they'll have a safe and easy entrance to pit road as well.
Yeah, as we look back at the back now, and we've got, you know, both Hensley, the Sergeants, and Gerringer back here, and Daryl Spear back here as well. Looks like those guys are the guys kind of lingering and waiting still, and I don't blame them. I mean, you've got to do something different.
Oh, you got our first takers to pit road.
20 of Russell Chernesky down pit road. We got Zach McDaniel down on pit road. Bobby Terrell. Looks like Whelan and Dealing. The whole team is coming.
Yeah, that's the way you got to do it. You got to have enough members of your team to really pay off to do this. So that's going to be the first one, and that was on lap 30. So obviously these guys cannot make it with one stop. They're assuming that they have to do two stops, a full stop, and then a splash at the end.
Yeah, this looks like a four-tire stop for these guys too. So interesting call here on lap 31. They're already in. This really changes the whole complexion of this race. Who can make it to lap 37? Anybody? I don't know.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting. You know, a four-tire stop is going to be the other thing. You know, I would not be surprised if their competitors only came down and took two. Save a little bit of time, you know, precious seconds off the stopwatch.
Yeah, going to be really tricky to see where they filter in here as we look in at Bobby Terrell and Russell Chernesky. Now, they're all alone. I think they've got, not sure who's trying to catch up to them, the first one there.
Well, the leaders are on the same straightaway, and they're going to be catching them very quickly. You know, the leaders right now, they're running prospectively 186 mile an hour, where Chernesky is running about a 160, 170. So there's a 20 mile an hour difference. It seems like the 81 and majority of the cars are going to be coming to pit road this time. There's a slew of cars are coming to pit road.
We've got a bunch down there. It looks like they're all getting in clean. A great job. Three wide, two wide. It looks like everybody's in clean. Just masterful job there.
It looks like we only have Skillhouse, Britton, Long, Brody Hanna, TJ Bartell, James Torrey. That sounds like a team to me. Jason Martin and David Hensley have yet to come to pit road. They're still out there. I expect to see them down pit road this time.
Should be coming in here. As we look at the exit of pit road here, looks like a lot of guys down and away. Everybody kind of together here. Almost everybody. Looks like a little bit of a lingering when we get back here.
Yeah, it looks like Fury.
The Sergeant's just a little bit behind there.
Yeah, it looks like the Fury Motorsports group is all coming to pit road this time. So, you know, as expected, the teams all come kind of pit road together.
Amazing workout here, though. I haven't seen anybody have a problem. I'm sure someone did, but we didn't catch anybody having an issue on pit road yet. I say that in the 55. That looks awful slow. That's probably pit road speed, but I think he's driving through, Brad. I think now he missed his stall.
Oh, that could be just disastrous. And we're going to see what here happens, because from where I'm looking at, I see Ronnie Royal pretty much the first group of cars out. They look like they got about a two-second lead. Ronnie Royal, Brandon Elder, Bernard Person, Lane Allen, all right there, nose-to-tail together in those four trucks. It seems like they're going to be the fastest trucks, as they're going to go by the Fury trucks as they exit pit road. So it looks like those are going to be our leaders.
This is different trucks, same teams we've seen at Daytona. You've got Spear Motorsports has got, you know, Bernard Person in there and Ronnie Royal. And you got Lane Allen and Brandon Elder representing Blackwater Motorsports. And here we go again, just like Daytona.
Yeah, I don't think they were able to get too far ahead. I think the 23 of Brody Hanna, the 7 of Jerry Carr, I mean, they're all close together, and they got about 10 or 15 trucks. I think they should be able to close the gap. So I don't think they're going to be able to run away from the field, but they're definitely distancing themselves. They probably cut this down to maybe a 20 truck field. They definitely took about half the competition off.
Yeah, they really did. I mean, they may not get away, but we're talking about some pretty strong trucks here. If anybody can do it, it's these guys, so we'll see how this plays out. Ronnie Royal, your leader, Brandon Elder in second, Bernard Person in third, and Lane Allen in that top four. David Shillhouse, last week's winner, or 2 weeks ago, I guess it was now, he's next, but he's all alone on the track.
Yeah, he's going to, the 7 of Jared Carr is going to be on top of him in a matter of moments. So he's probably going to end up filtering somewhere in the 12th position as the cars are going to be closing in very fast on him. So he'll be lucky to be able to jump on the back. But he will not lose the draft. It's going to be about, probably about 5 or 6 laps, I say, before they're able to close the gap on that first four.
I don't know. These guys back here not doing a great job of getting locked up. Big gap front two in this pack, and back to TJ Bartell. This is not what you want to see when you're trying to run down the leaders.
No, but you know, if we look at the speed of the two, so the 81 of Ronnie Royal right now, he's running about a 187. And if we go back and we look at the likes of Jared Carr, Brody Hannah, they're also right there at 187, 188. But through the corners, they're maintaining their 187, 188, where Ronnie Royal and them are dropping down to 184, 185. So that second pack is definitely faster. They're not making huge gains, but they are going to chip away at it as more cars get single file in those lines. And they're going to essentially catch up to them. It's just a matter of time.
Well, that'll bring up another interesting plot twist then. If that's the case, when they do get there, these guys up front, do they go 2x2, kind of block the track? Do they stay down here and try and fight them off, and try and filter in behind? Lots to think about as this group approaches. So we watched Tracy Powers there. I think that was him on the high side. He's a couple laps down and as the field goes by him. Back up front, the 81/32 of Ronnie Royal still leading. Brandon Elder still in that second spot. Bernard Person and Lane Allen as the group behind them, the mob, is coming. And now you got Casey McMullen Sr. on the outside of Jared Carr starting to show his strength. He's got Sherwood Williford with him as well as David Shillhouse.
Yeah, absolutely. That second group is really coming, and you know, they're right now 2.5 seconds behind. Sorry about that, I had a technical difficulty there. They're about 2.5 seconds behind, but you know what? They can see them in front of them. It's only going to be a matter of about another lap before they start getting a sniff of that drift off, that draft off the cars in front. And you know, sometimes, believe it or not, running 2x2 is faster. Believe it or not, you would never think it is, but sometimes we found out in the sim that it is faster. They're running about a 190 right now, where our leaders are only running 185. So you know, they got a five mile an hour advantage over our leaders, and they're going to be on top of them in a matter of laps.
Yeah, it's a weird anomaly there where they, you know, they create a bigger pocket of in the air or something to that effect, and they're just able to get that whole group moving faster. But they're definitely going to catch.
Yeah, that lap right there, they were able to cut a second off of it. And what the real thing is, exactly what you were saying earlier, Jared Carr's going to have to make that decision. He's going to be closing in on these guys at 5-6 mile an hour faster. Do you just drag the brake and jump in line, or do you go to the outside and try to use all the momentum you got? I'll tell you right now, if Jared Carr doesn't jump to the outside, that 23 with Brody Hannah, he's going to go to the outside. I expect Jared Carr to go to the outside. If not, he's going to get boxed in. As a 23, he was kind of peaking, and he stayed low, and Jared Carr goes to the outside, just as suspected.
Yeah, Brody's really pushing here as these guys come by on the outside. Really surprised the front four didn't go 2x2 there and kind of block the track. I mean, I guess it might not have been the most gentlemanly thing to do, but I think it would have been the wise thing to do.
Well, you know what? These guys know the scoreboard. You know, they all took four tires. They're out front. They're going to stay in this lead pack. They figured that they're going to be able to wind up, what, worst case, third and fourth out of this. And let's face it, they had the best pit stop out of all of the teams. We know another pit stop has to happen. You got to bank on that. Right now, the one thing you don't want to do is get wrecked. So it's a good move on their part. And, you know, looking back in the field, the last car on this pack is going to be the number 9 of Jason Martin. He's currently in the 19th position. We're a little over 12 and a half seconds back to our 20th place truck. So we were able to take out 11 cars in one round of pit stops. So,
yeah, that's, you know, that's Brian Conklin leading that group back there. He was racing up front the whole time. So Brian Conklin having some issues along with everybody in this group. And something has happened to Terry Cooper Jr. showing a lap down, as well as Tracy Powers, Jeff, and Jeff Bratton. Tracy three laps down, Jeff Bratton a single lap down. So lots of troubles out there, pretty much as you predicted. You know, you're going to lose that many cars during the pit stop.
Yeah, some of the guys just aren't going to be clean. They're not going to be as fast getting in or out. They're not going to make the right decision. You know, you come down with a group of 10 cars, 9 of them take 2, you're the only guy that takes 4. You're out. You're a lap down.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. So we're on lap 34 here, or 34 to go, by mistake. So we're looking at last pit stops with, I don't know, Brad, anywhere around the 20 to go mark, 25 to go maybe even. I don't think you, on a super speedway, you want to come in early. It's a tricky call, man.
Yeah, I mean, it all depends. I mean, do you think there's going to be a caution? I mean, that's what I go back to every time. Do you think there's going to be a caution? If you think there's going to be a caution, you stay out as long as you can. You think this is going to stay green, you got a big enough team, you got 6-7 guys, you roll the dice. You do what they don't, you force them into it, because you pit early, they might sit there and say, okay, well, we better pit early. You just roll the dice.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, I don't know if you could have enough cars unless you get two teams together to really make that kind of a difference to come in early or not. But we're seeing that, you know, these guys made that decision to stay on that low line. And, you know, as usually they do, proving me wrong, really, as they're still running nose to tail on that inside line, they're where they want to be. So ultimately, it looks like they made the right decision.
Well, the way you got to look at it is, you know you're not going to go a lap down. You know you're only going to take, I would assume that they would only take the minimum amount of fuel to get back up. So they're not going to go a lap down. Worst case scenario is the field's going to catch back up to them, and they're going to be able to ride around in the pack at the front of the field at that higher speed. So you're not really going to necessarily lose anything. It's just a matter of how long it takes to cycle. Now, if you get out, you're able to get a little bit of distance on the field or something like that, it can really play to your strengths or a caution. But I don't expect to see anybody really doing anything for probably about another 15 laps or so. So right around lap 60, I'm going to expect people to start really making that move to pit road.
Yeah, there's nothing really you have to do in this pack. Even the last car in this pack, you don't have to do anything until after pit stops. There's no gain to gain a few car lengths or whatever. You're all going to hit pit road together. It's who can get in there the cleanest and who can race with no tires perhaps, or maybe only 2. As we see Jeff Marble kind of sliding up the track a bit. I'm not sure if he's got a bit of an issue. He's filed in front of Jason Martin.
Yeah, the only thing I may start doing if I was one of these guys is, you know, especially the guys a little bit further back in the field, you know, your Casey McMullins, your Tyler Marbles, your Shohas, your Rutherfords, maybe start testing that third lane. Not necessarily to make up spots, but to see who you can trust to go with you. You know, you might be able to run that third lane all day long, but if the person pushing you can't, it's not going to make any difference. So you want to really be able to make sure that you got somebody who can run that third lane, you know, without a problem. Maybe, you know, take a couple of corners, see how far you can get, kind of fall back, and just kind of see and play out the different scenarios that could happen. Because if you're going to hang out in the back and this has been your strategy, you're going to have to go to the third lane.
Yeah, you're going to definitely have to go to the third lane. I think some guys are comfortable there, others are not. But as we check in that second group, Brad, I don't know if we've been paying much attention, but are these guys losing time still? Are they hanging in there? What's the prognosis with the second group here?
Yeah, unfortunately, in about the last 4 laps, they've lost about another 3 seconds. The 11 of Matthew Geringer, 52 of Larry Anderson, Tim Bills, unfortunately, they're running, let's see, currently they're running a 186 mile an hour as our leader up front's running a 187. So the mile per hour isn't necessarily the biggest difference, but they're definitely losing a little bit of time. It's kind of give or take, you know, maybe a tenth here, a tenth there, back and forth, but they're definitely not making any big gains. If you're this group, you might want to play the strategy. Hey, we're losing time. Pit now. Get it over with. Roll the dice. Because you know you're 15 seconds back. You're not going to make that up.
Yeah, that's a good point. I mean, there's all kinds of different strategy you can play on a super speedway. Now, when you're 15 seconds back, you can't really pit and stay on the lead lap, I don't believe. But the leaders here could. I think they could come in and get gas only and be well on the lead lap. Now, they're going to get passed by the group after about 5 or 10 laps, probably. But it might be enough. It's hard to say. It's always a gamble trying to figure out all these things as you go. I mean, generally, what we'd do is go one after, you know. I don't know why. I like to have the track position. Usually the guys, you'll come out in front of the guys who've already pitted. They're going to have momentum, but I'll have the track position.
Right. Well, this group is a group of nine, if you will. So they're chasing down 19. All right. So we know the cars in front of them aren't pushing. They're running nose to tail, but nobody's really pushing. These guys need to either decide that they're going to push and try to go all in and try to get as fast as they can, or they need to do something else to really turn the table. You know, even a blistering perfect pit stop isn't going to gain you, as they lost another 0.3 seconds that lap. So they got to decide whether or not they're going to race each other like they have been, or if they're going to work together to try to close the gap.
Right on board with Brody Hanna here. You can see that he's right up there at the bumper of Jared Carr. Probably not as aggressive yet as he will be near the end of the race, but nonetheless pushing hard. We've seen him go by Tracy Powers there, getting lapped on the outside. A little bit scary from this view when it, you know, you just peek out to the right a bit, and boom, there's a truck.
Yeah, that's just it. A lot of people don't realize, you know, in these trucks, there's not a whole lot of visibility. They're a lot taller than you think. That spoiler's a lot bigger. The fuel abuse not exactly the greatest. When you're tucked up on the back of somebody, you're really going to do it. As we stay on board with Brody Hanna here, you'll notice down the straightaway, he's going to come off just a little bit, gain a little bit of momentum just to be able to push, get a push on him. And once we get to the entrance of the corners, he's going to back off a little bit, give him a little bit of room, stay a little bit high, get a little bit of air to that nose, as the 7 truck's going to go down to the bottom and he's going to stay on the outside. This may be a little bit of team moves. He's going to maybe be able to pass him and go down underneath.
Interesting there to watch Jared jump to the inside. It almost looked like Brody went high, but no, the 7 down to the inside, taking that spot away. And that's an interesting move, as the 51 is still down there in that second place spot. So we've lost the 52 somehow has been shooken out of that lead by the 51 and now by the 7 of Jared Carr.
As we get a little bit later on in this race, you're going to start seeing a little bit of teammate work. So you might see a guy on the outside finally get the lead. He'll come down into the bottom lane and then he'll slowly just drag the brake ever so slightly, if you will. Just allowing his teammate on the outside to finally get a run and get past him so he can go down on the bottom. You know, some guys don't really like that. You know, it's kind of one of those arguments of, you know, what do we do? But it's part of
racing. It's part of super speedway racing. And it's strategy. I mean, I can definitely understand people not liking it, but what I would encourage them to do is get some teammates. And
for the race, and you're really going to get that.
I think we're having some technical difficulties here, but other than that, we got Brody Hanna up high with TJ Bartell. Now, I don't know if they're exactly teammates at Fury Motorsport, but they do work together. They are friendly, so we can consider them Super Speedway teammates. And we've got the 51 and the 14 here together. We've got the 8 and the 32/81 working together. Looks like James Torrey up there. I think he's in part of Fury or Shock and Awe as well. Get a couple of these teams mixed up. Sorry, guys. But a few guys, it looks like the top side kind of working together. The inside is a little scattered, but there are two teammates behind them. So it'll be interesting to see how this all plays out.
Yeah, absolutely. And if you look a little bit further back, we got still got the 25 of Terry Cooper Jr. is back there. You know, you've got 33 Sherwood Rowford. David Hensley's back there. So you still got a lot of quality trucks that haven't necessarily shown their hand yet. And I think you're going to get a little bit of that. You're going to have some guys that are going to be some late comers where they're just kind of making sure they finish. They got a little bit more at stake as far as points or something like that. So they need to make sure that they don't give anything up. But you're gonna—it's gonna be an interesting last couple of 10, 15 laps.
Oh, it really is, man. We're getting down to 23 to go here at the line, and you know, everything's status quo here. As you can just imagine, the team radios right now. What are we doing? What are we doing? Should we come in early? Should we stay out? Gas only. Two tires. Four tires. You guys are going crazy trying to figure this all out. Usually, you just need one guy. It really doesn't matter what you're gonna do, as long as you do it all together.
Yeah, absolutely. I hate to say it, there's always that one guy, he comes down pit road, he thinks he's got everything checked off, and he gets in his box, and what happens? Truck starts getting jacked up. He's sitting there on four tires. He forgot to take the tires off. Race is over for him. This is one of those things that you really got to make sure that you have good communication down, how much fuel you're going to take, how much tires you're going to take. You know, you want to get in together, you want to get out together. As we got the 51 of Brandon Elder going to the outside, he's going to be pushed by the 81/32 Ronnie Roll. He's going for the lead, as he's going to take the lead on that one.
Yeah, Brandon Elder to the lead. Excellent to see him up there. Been a struggle this year for Brandon, one of the all-time winningest drivers in FTSR history. Been struggling for months and months now. Here he is in the lead with 22 to go at the Talladega 200.
Here's my question to you, Dean. Do you want to be the guy out front, or do you want to be the guy pushing?
Oh, man. I always like to be in the lead. Like, I just do. But it's a tricky question because it depends on who's pushing me. I mean, I got to have a comfort level. And that's where teammates come in. People that you practice with come in. You got to know who you're working with, believe in them, and trust them. Because if you don't, you feel at all uncomfortable. Not only will they possibly make a mistake, or that's what you're thinking, those thoughts will make you make a mistake.
And you know what? Right as you said that, we had the 81 of Ryan Royal pushing on the back of that 51 of Brian Elder in the middle of the trial. He decided he was going to duck down and go to the inside and actually take the lead away, or at least try to take the lead away from the 81. So that's the other thing you're going to get when you're the leader. You know, do you trust that person to stay with you behind you? I mean, personally, I'd rather, it doesn't matter if I'm the leader or the guy in second, I just want to be on the outside. I don't want to be on that inside lane.
See, I'm the exact opposite. I like the inside lane. Now, that's as a leader. I don't like to be trapped down, you know, in third or fourth on the inside lane. But the reason I like the inside lane during the race, I guess I would say, is wreck avoidance. If you're on the high side, there's just nowhere to go. If I'm on the low side, I go all the way off, down in the grass, wherever I got to go to avoid people.
Yeah, it's always a little bit of difference, and that's what makes super speedway racing so great, the different philosophies, the different styles that go into it, the different you know, things that people like. As we got the 7 of Jared Carr, it looks like he's going to go to the outside right now, try to take a little bit of momentum from that 51, the 51 to try to go to the lead.
Well, these are like you were just alluding to, the finer points of super speedway racing. Now here, you know, they backed off a little bit on the outside line, maybe getting some air, taking it easy for a minute, whatever the case may be, but you've left an opening, and someone's always going to fill that opening. Jared Carr did. Now you're stuck a little bit behind. So, you know, it's a lot trickier than what it looks like on TV or on here on YouTube. I mean, this guy's got a lot to deal with.
Absolutely. Right now, you know what, everybody's cool with working with each other. You know, the 51 didn't have a problem coming up to the back of the 7 and giving him a little push. But as we get later into this run and that same move happens, that 51's going to go to the outside of that 7, because why should I give you the free ride? Why should I push you? I got my buddy behind me, he's pushing me, and we're going to go around you on the outside, and we're going to leave you in the middle. And it's just going to get a little bit more intense as we go, a little more intense. As you know what? Something's happened with some of the guys a little bit towards the back. You know, we got the 42 of Zach McDaniels. He's a little bit over a second back. You know, he's still in touch with the leaders and whatnot, but he's fallen to the back. He was a little bit closer. I don't know if it's something where he just wanted to get with his teammates, or he's just starting to feel a little bit uncomfortable in the race.
It looks like he's fine. He's just falling back there a bit, perhaps preparing himself for this pit stop upcoming here, as we're in 18 to go. They're imminent here. Any lap now, these guys are all coming down pit road. And I don't know, in a group that's, you know, been reduced already, Brad, to, you know, are these guys all going to want to come in together?
I don't think you're going to get everybody. Again, I think you're going to get, just like last time, you're going to get teams coming together. You might have two teams coming together, but there's no way everybody's going to make it down pit road together. And, you know, it kind of tells you right now, just by the way they're lined up, you're going to start seeing guys go to the outside, teammates. Guys go to the inside, teammates, and that's how they're going to come to pit road, I think. And ultimately, that's where you're going to get. You're seeing the Blackwater guys starting to slowly make their way down to the bottom. 71 Casey McMullen drops down to the bottom that time. And that's what we're going to get. You're going to get two distinctive groups. And this time, who gets it is going to be key, because if we split this field in half, they might not bridge the gap back together.
Yeah, they definitely might not. And, you know, interesting point, the 71, he's got his teammate Terry Cooper Jr. there, a lap down, but he could be a factor here. He's in the lead group. You need teammates, you need friends, and here's one, lap down or not, he's going to help.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, you know, teammates are great, but when you look in the mirror and you know the guy and you trust the guy, that's what really matters here.
As we edge down to 17 to go, maybe 16 to go right now. I mean, Jared Carr looking to the inside, not sure if he wants it or not. He's going to stay up high here.
Yeah, I think that was actually a mistake. He should have filled out bottom, and I think the 51 really needed him to. I think the 51 was getting to the point where he needed a little bit of hot air, gave him everything he could to get him clear, and that 7 just kind of hesitated on it. Now the 51's going to be the one that ends up paying for it.
Now maybe he might leave him in a minute. I can see that he's starting to push really hard, perhaps getting frustrated. I can see the 51 darting to the high side here and seeing if anybody would go with him.
Yeah, it might be a little bit early for that, especially with pit stops looming. But definitely I wouldn't be surprised if that 7 and the 51 start falling back a little bit on that top side, just for the simple fact that you could kind of see it. And just to what you're alluding to, you know, he's really pushing him, trying to get him clear, because I think you might be having a little bit of temp issue in that 51, because he's been on the back of that 7 for a while. And, you know, as you see him going a little bit more to the outside, he just can't hold that temperature.
Trying to get air into that grill there and every corner, and that's how you do it here. When you're running hot, you got to swing that thing out of, like, in the corners, try and get a little air in it. But you see him doing it on the straightaways as well. He's definitely overheating.
Yeah, exactly. And that's one of the things where, you know, I talked about earlier, is you got to work together as the guy in front and the guy in the back. You got to know, you know, you want to be in the top side, but that guy's been helping you this entire time. He's been working at getting you in the lead. You know, you got to drop down and give him clean air.
No takers. Coming down to 14 to go. We got pit stops any lap now, and this is where the race will be won and lost, or at least lost, maybe not won, but several guys will lose their way out of this group.
I'll tell you what, some of the guys out of that second group, they've made their way to pit road. 77 of Tim Bills, Larry Anderson, they've made it down to pit road. So pit stops are starting. I expect in the next lap or two, these main guys to start coming down.
Oh, yeah. They're just, this game's being played here. Are they going to go? Are we going to go? Who's going first? I mean, gas mileage-wise, they can probably go a few more. And Brandon Elder, down to the inside. You got, looks like the 8 of Bernard Person coming down pit road. Not a bunch of friends with them, though. There is 4 guys.
Yep, Persons, Sherwood, I believe we saw Hensley. So he's got
with these guys.
Yeah, he's got teammates with him. So it's going to be interesting to see what Jared Carr is going to do, as he got down to the inside. The 51 was able to actually clear down with him. Hannah's on the outside. I expect to see some of these guys go in the next lap or two.
So Person down and away, Hensley's down and away, looks like Ronnie Royal, but the 33 is Sherwood Williford with a bad stop. He's going to lose these guys.
Yeah, Looks like we're going to get a couple more takers this time. It's going to be Jeff Marble along with
Tyler,
yes.
So Team Marble's in now with only two of them. This is going to be really interesting to see how this all filters out here as the lead pack continues to go around. We're at 12 to go, coming down to 11 to go here. Jared Carr, your current leader. Brody Hanna on the outside. Brandon Elder, number two on the inside. TJ Bartell and Lane Allen in the top five.
Okay, so currently we got the 81 of Ryan Royal, David Hensley, and you got the 8 of Bobby Terrell, or Bernard Persons, excuse me. They're coming down, and they are in the middle of the trial right now. It's Jared Carr. They're going to be exiting four, but it looks like they're coming to pit road now. So that's going to be the interesting one. That's who we're going to have to mark. We're going to be able to look at Ronnie Royal and see where everybody comes out.
Looks like a decent job there. Four wide coming onto pit road. They're going to get in clean. Can they get to their stalls clean? Looks like it's going to be a really good job by everybody here. Oh, a little bit of action there at the back. Everybody down and away. Now, my thinking is this group is going to be best off, at least compared to this four-car group that got out there at the beginning. And that was Ronnie Royal and them. And there they are. They're the three-car group, sorry. Sherwood didn't quite make it to these guys. As they come on by here, they're looking pretty good to get up here and probably take the lead.
Yeah, they got a good head of steam. They're coming through one and two right now as they're actually passing those group of cars. But the big difference is the next group going to be able to get formed up quick enough to be able to run them back down. We're on lap 65, so we got 10 laps to go. I think they'll have enough time. The big thing will be is once they get there, will they be able to do anything?
Really surprised that this group, only a three-car group there, managed to get out here and get the lead. They must have had really good pit stops. But the interesting point here is a couple of movers and shakers. We've got the 71 of Casey McMullen Sr. leading that second group. David Schildhaus and Russell Chernowski, part of Whelan and Dillon Motorsports there. They're together in this group. And they need these other four behind them. You got Jared Carr back here. You got the four of Bobby Terrell. It looks like Lane Allen's in there and Terry Cooper Jr. They have got to catch this group, form up. We're on 10 to go. Not a whole lot of time to get it done here.
And I'll tell you what, that 23 of Brody Hanna and the 21 of TJ Bartell, they made their pit stop. They came out nose to tail. They're going to be right on the inside of that 71. So they did a great pit stop as well. They're going to fall in line. So now that's going to be a five-truck field, if you will, trying to run down our leaders of Ronnie Royal, David Hensley, and Bernard Persson. So,
oh, there's a wreck! I seen that coming. The 20 of Russell Chernowski. He tried to slip down in front of Brody Hanna. There just wasn't any room. And Brody Hanna got into him a little bit, and he is down and around. His night is over.
That's right, but you know what? He spun to the inside. He spun down pit road. We do not have a caution. That will help the front three, but I think it's only a matter of time before the 71 and Schildhaus, along with Hanna and the 20, are going to get hooked up together. They're going to be able to pull back a little bit of time. They've got that slipstream. I think they're going to be there. The big question here is, are you going to get the likes of Jared Carr, Bobby Terrell, Lane Allen, Jason Martin? Are they going to be able to close up the distance?
I think they are. I think you're looking at a 12-car pack for the finish of this race. Going to be really interesting here. Really unfortunate for the 20 of Russell Chernowski. Just tried a little too much to fit in line. Didn't realize it really wasn't that important at that time in the race. And that's tragedy for him and that team. But right now, Casey McMullen Sr. on the high side. He's got Schildhaus with him in the 62. And they're riding. They got a big head of steam here on the outside, but with four or five cars on the inside, I don't know if they can do it.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, Mark, it's going to be interesting. This is going to be a good battle here, but you know what? That seven truck of Jared Carr, he's going to get there, and you know what? He's going to be the first guy to put it three wide. He's been very aggressive this entire night. He sees the laps closing down. He's going to come with a big head of steam coming from the back. He's going to have a lot of draft. I expect to see him jump straight to the outside, and then once he finally closes in on Skiles, go to the third lane.
What an interesting finish we're setting up for here. As it looks like Casey McMullen Sr. got that lap. He's going to be your new leader here. Still can't quite clear of the drop down to the inside. But that outside group now with Brody Hanna and TJ Bartell joining in. Looks like they got the advantage at this current time.
Yeah, if you look back, that pack closing in, it looks like there's a lot of people that don't necessarily want to work together. It seems like Derek Carr's getting left on the outside.
Look like Schilhaus looking to make it three wide there, and he is. He's going to be hung out to dry, though. He's gone up the track by himself. Nobody's going with him. Unfortunate for Schilhaus. Again, should have recognized the situation. No teammates, no friends with you, and they're probably not going to go with you.
Yeah, it could be a possibility, too, where, you know, he spent a lot of time pushing them to try to make up that distance. Could have been a difference of, you know, just not having the temperatures, and better part of valor was to pull out and save the motor and try to get it, go back.
We're three wide and someone's around. Oh, he's saving it. Lane Allen saving it with Jared Carr on the inside of him. He was slamming doors there. Sideways was the 14. What a great job by Lane Allen. A great point on the 62. Yes, you're probably right. I'm probably a little harsh on him there. He's probably just said, you know what, I'm about to blow up. Let me pull out. I mean, it's a small group, still in it.
Yeah, but you know what? As you saw, you know, they're getting up real tight. You know, the give and take is over. Now it's all about taking. I want to be the first person across that line. It doesn't matter if we're bumping doors. We're going to be in it for the entire remainder of this race.
Yeah, as we come down to five to go, we got the 81 of Ronnie Royal in the lead, the 71 on the outside of Casey McMullen Sr., David Hensley making an appearance here at the front, that familiar 43. You got the 8 of Bernard Person. Brody Hanna's in there. Jason Martin. TJ Bartell. You got Jared Carr looking to the high side. Bobby Terrell's back here.
Yeah, and you know what? I want to really tip my cap to that 43 of David Hensley. He started 30th. He's currently in the second position. He's hung out in the back the entire race. Played his strategy. Where is he at? With under 5 to go, he's sitting second. So he's done a masterful job in this race. I think he's only biding his time. I don't know if he's content with pushing the 81 or if he's just kind of setting him up with him at the time.
Yeah, David, just he's won before at these super speedways. He does a great job of being cautious early and racing late. Here he is again in second place. Everybody's pulling for the 43, man. He might as well be Richard Petty himself. Everybody loves David Hensley.
Yeah, I think you're seeing a little bit of cage in this. You know, you got the veteran out there, the 23 of Brody Hanna. You got the 71 of Casey McMullen. You're not seeing a whole lot of pushing. You know, they're trying to make sure that they have it set up to where they have enough temperatures to really make a run at it for the last few laps. They're not letting it, they're keeping a fender, if you will, on that 43 to where he can't necessarily come up. But Brody is not going to push on the back of that 71 until it's time to go.
That's the key we talked about earlier in the race. You cannot leave that spot open or someone will fill it like Hensley. But here we go. They're making their run now. Brody Hanna pushing for all he's worth. The 71 has got the lead. Will he come down the track? I know Casey. He likes the high side. I think he's going to stay up here. And that's going to frustrate that 23 probably.
Yeah, but you know what? That 81 loves it. They were able to pull it back and the 43 go right on by. You know, he might be able to do something. And if that's the case, you know, you figure out the rhythm. You figure out how this goes. Right now, we know if you're that 43, you know, hey, he likes to push off a 4. He likes to push him through the straight, through the tri-oval. But by the time you come off a 2, you have the availability to jump up to that high side. It's just a matter of whether or not you think that 71's a good enough pusher to take him with you. But I expect to see that 43 pop out. And you know what? It might be that 8 truck that pops out.
Yeah, the 8 looking to pop out right now. No real room there, just a little late on the move. But he was definitely looking as the 71 and the 23 start to make their run on the outside again. Here they come.
Don't look now, that 21. He could be a big factor. TJ Bartell on the inside. He's got to get to the back of the 23, give him a good shot. But what he's got to do is make sure he stays off him, because the last thing we want to do is be pushing the truck that's already pushing somebody. That could spell disaster.
We are on 2 to go. The outside with Hanna and McMullen. The inside, you've got Royal and Person. I mean, and Hensley as well.
Yep, we're starting to look at it for three wide. We're sitting there and we got Schildhouse. He's going to go to the outside. Terry Cooper Jr. is going to go with him. You know, what is this going to do? Is if they get the birdie head, is he going to pop out and try to take it to the third lane and try to get by Casey McMullen? Right now, if you're sitting down in the bottom lane, you're kind of stuck in it. You know, they're going to pinch you down as much as they can, but you got to hold on for everything you got. You pretty much, you're in the lane you're in.
Down through one, going through two. The 81-32 of Ronnie Royal leading this thing. David Hensley is in second. McMullen and Hannah on the outside. Schildhouse up high. He can't make it happen. Oh, and Hensley's blown his engine. David Hensley has blown his engine on the last lap. That's going to allow the outside Casey McMullen to get that lead. Brody Hannah down to the inside. Here we come around. It's Hannah down low taking the lead. Casey McMullen on high. He's got help. TJ Bartel to the outside. Three wide coming to the line. Four wide. Oh, and McMullen's hit. Hannah's hit. TJ Bartel at the line. Wow. What an unbelievable finish. TJ Bartel will take home this victory. That was just an incredible finish, Brad.
It really was. I mean, they waited until the absolute last minute. And, you know, unfortunately for the 43, blowing his engine, it really opened up the door for everybody else. TJ Bartel, Casey McMullen, Brody Hannah, Schildhouse, everybody. You know, it was every man for himself, and it was beautiful to see.
Man, I'm out of breath. Let's get a replay here. Let's get in the cockpit of the 81 here and just see what he's seen as we're coming towards the line. He's riding in here. McMullen's up high. He's trying to find some spot. He hits them both. The 81 just drills them both coming to the line. We'll take a couple another looks at this, folks. We'll try it from a chopper. See what we can see here. Back it up a little bit more. We were four wide there. As we come through, Hannah's lead, McMullen. You got Schildhouse makes it four wide. Big run from Ronnie Royal. He hits both Hannah and McMullen. They go three wide to the line. They hit each other, all of them. Wow, just unbelievable.
It couldn't have worked out any better for Freer Motorsports with them being the home of the 23 of Brody Hannah and TJ Bartel. You know, both of them were able to work together and really make it at the end.
That was an incredible finish, man. That is one of the best finishes ever. Now, I don't know what Ronnie Royal there was trying to fit his truck because there was like no opening whatsoever, but he tried something.
At that point, you really don't have much to lose.
Yeah, I don't know what I want to say about that part of it, but here we are with TJ Bartel doing his sort of burnout with a very broken up truck here. Wow, you can't be happier for a guy like TJ Bartel, though. Taking this victory is just a, wow, I'm out of breath, Brad. That was incredible.
It really was, you know, for a race that had a lot of technicality to it, a lot of, you know, kind of wait to see who makes the mistakes. At the end of the day, it was just, you know, it was all guts and, you know, I'm going to make it. I'm going to put it three wide. I'm going to put it four wide. You know, I'm not lifting. It doesn't matter what happened. You know, they pushed their machines, the motors, everything right to the limit. And it really showed. And it was a great finish.
Super exciting. Let's check in on our results here. Of course, TJ Bartel in the 21, taking home that super exciting victory here. Casey McMullen Sr. doing a great job, coming home in second after playing it cool most of the race. Brody Hannah was back there with him early in the race as well. The 23 will take third place. Schildhouse will take fourth. Bernard Persson won a fifth. Jason Martin sixth. Bobby Terrell 7th, Ronnie Royal in 8th, Jared Carr 9th, and Lane Allen round out the top 10.
Left is going to be Tyler Marble, followed by Zach McDaniel. 13th is going to be Jeff Marble, 14th Brandon Elder. Matthew Gehringer is going to bring home 15th, Donnie Staubach 16th, 17th is going to be the 33 of Sherwood Wilford, followed by Tim Bills, Larry Anderson, Brian Bliss, Kevin Sargent, Brian Conklin, David Hensley, unfortunately, with that last lap motor blow. Terry Cooper Jr., 24th. James Torrey, 25th. Russell Charneski, 26th. Jeff Bratton, 27th. Paul Sargent, Steve Loomis, Tracy Powers, and William Long will round out our field.
Wow. David Hensley, man. Heartbreaking there. Blowing an engine there. Kind of setting us up for that finish because he blew his engine. Bernard Persson got a little loose behind him. Kind of had to do what he had to do to hang in there, and then they got that bigger run and allowed other people to get in there, and four wide, man, coming to the line. Super exciting stuff. But we'll come back. We'll take a short break here. We'll come back. We'll get interviews with our top three. You don't want to miss that, man. And we'll wrap up this show.
It starts right here and right now. Let's go racing from Daytona. PA record fourth career championship, and Ray Alfala back to the top of the mountain, and Garrett Lowe pushes the 30 out of the way. He'll come back on him now. Nick Ottinger on the inside, winner of the eNASCAR iRacing All-Star Race. We'll squeeze on the outside, and for the first time, Zach Novak is an eNASCAR iRacing Series champion.
Look at this. Three wide for the race lead into turn one in Indianapolis.
All right, welcome back to Talladega Super Speedway here in the Blackwater Products USA Truck Series with Full Throttle Sim Racing. What a race we had, Brad. Just, you know, you can't say enough. These guys took it easy all race long. You know, some even it gets a little boring almost at times. Not a whole lot going on. But boy, did they give us something to talk about at the end here.
Oh, man, they really did. I mean, you know, as you said, you know, sometimes you can get kind of lulled into a sense of security and you're just kind of logging laps, trying to make it to the end. But, man, they were setting up for something. You know, there was definitely a plan. All these teams had their own plans. And, boy, I don't think anybody planned the finish that we had today.
On you, I think.
I doubt they did plan for it. Man, that was just incredible action, Brad. Right now, I'm here with our third place finisher out of that mayhem, the 23 of Brody Hanna. Brody, congrats on third place, man.
I just got one question. I got to ask you and ask the fans, was it worth it? Was it worth the wait to get a four wide finish at the end? That was awesome. That was great.
And yes, it was. It was completely worth it. We talked about it there just a bit in our wrap-up that, you know, it's kind of, it's just a little, I don't want to use the word boring, but whatever, as you go along. I thought it was a great race all around. We thought it was very highly entertaining. But, you know, you get lulled into the security, as Brad put it, and then here we go at the end. Just incredible action, man. I don't think I've ever seen a finish like that. Just blew my mind. I'm so excited right now, Brody, and I'm happy you survived. I'm happy you got third place, man. Congrats.
It was a lot of fun at the end. The beginning, yes, a little boring. I read back there with me and Will, just read back in the back for a little while, just kind of watching things, watching and waiting for our first pit stop. We do our pit stop, come back out, catch up with the pack, wait some more, make our last pit stop. It's
well,
just,
to,
you know.
To interject on that, Brody, so we watched you, okay? We were watching, we went back, we're like, oh, there's Casey McMullen, there's Brody Hanna, Will Long. They're riding out here, we're talking about the strategy, and all of a sudden, you guys started moving. You took that outside lane and just walked by about 20 cars. Talk a little bit about that.
Well, we had good trucks all night. We know we did, but what happened is that the inside lane started checking up, everybody jockeying for a position to pit. And I was like, I told Will, I said, well, we might as well go and make up some time anyway. So we just pulled up there behind those guys and waited for some of those guys to pit so we could pit because we couldn't get down.
Yeah, we thought it was a great strategy. I mean, I usually wouldn't, you know, go for that when I'm trying to play it safe, but it was so wide open, and you were doing it so easily. It was effortless. It was just great. Pick up 20 spots. You're in a better position for pitting, and it really played out. Now, talk a little bit about the pits. We've seen the first pits, you know, we lost maybe 10 cars or something. That's to be expected. You know, everybody got grouped back up. And then you had that last pit, and there was a little different strategies, little smaller groups working together. We weren't too sure if you're going to get broken up or not, but you managed to get all grouped back up again.
We did do a little bit different on the second. The first pit stop, we took two tires and full can of fuel. The second pit stop, I got to give James Torrey credit because he was working on fuel mileage for us and told us kind of what we needed. So we took a little less fuel, two tires, and was able to get back out there with a group and actually run down the top two or three that were in front of us. So it kind of put us in good position. We were riding there at the end. I told TJ because he was behind me, I was like, well, I could clearly push the 71 at the end, but I didn't know what the call would be there. And then on the last lap, I hated to see it. David blew up, the 43, David Hensley. And so it opened the bottom up. So I was like, well, I don't know if Casey knew that. He was still running the second lane. So I darted down the inside lane, and it was close. And I told TJ at that point, I said, TJ, do what you got to do, man. And he sure did. He got that win. That's awesome for him.
Oh, it was super exciting. All three of you guys hit each other. Ronnie Royal hitting the back end of two of you. Super exciting. Yeah, everybody hates to see David Hensley blow up. We were super stoked to see him up there at the end of the race. But you've got to be very happy. I know I am. TJ Bartel grabbing the win. Teammate slash friend. And, you know, a longtime member here at Full Throttle Sim Racing.
Yeah, I think everybody's going to be happy to see him get that win, get that monkey off his back, hopefully. And he worked hard all race, was really smart all race. Everybody really was. It was really a good race for a Super Speedway race. And but yeah, as far as that goes, super excited for him. It's awesome. I'm glad he got the win. Glad I could be a part of that finish, though, man. I tell you, we were talking in the channel before. It's awesome. It's something that will stick in your head for the rest of your online racing career.
It absolutely will. It'll stick in mine. I'm sure it'll stick in Brad's. And so I congratulate you on third place. I congratulate you on owning this league, Brody, and putting on such a fantastic show and racing with some of these great racers. Congratulations, man.
Thanks. And to that point, again, it's nothing we do. It's these guys putting the time and the effort in, working on setups, working around each other. Just doing what they need to do to stay clean and keep a clean race. And I couldn't ask for anything more. I mean, that's awesome. And I hope everybody enjoyed it.
All right, Brad, that's Brody Hannon, man. Third place tonight. What a great job he did.
Absolutely. You know what? Nobody expected the finish that we got, but I don't think it's really a thing to say that we didn't expect Brody Hannon not to sit there and push somebody to the finish and go for the win. But you know what? I'm standing by with our second place finisher, the Blackwater Motorsports truck of Casey McMullen. Casey, you know, you started 28th on this grid, a little bit of strategy right off the bat. You brought that sucker home in second place in a dramatic fashion. You know, tell me a little bit about your night. You know, it seemed like early you were really trying to play a little bit of strategy, you know, stay out of trouble or whatnot in the back. Kind of just walk me through where we got, how we got to where we were.
Yeah, started in the back, just waited and waited and waited, and before pit stops there, decided to try to get back up to the front there and get a good pit stop, and pit stops were pretty good for me tonight. Yeah, we lost a couple teammates on the first pit stop, and then I lost a couple on the next one, and then it was just me on the outside line there with Brody and David Shieldhouse a little bit, and I was just trying to keep that second groove because that's my favorite groove, and turned out pretty good finish there.
Yeah, we mentioned that a couple of times during this the broadcast, at least, that, you know, we kind of expected that. That's the way kind of super speedways work, you know. The big separator is always pit stops. You know, the first, it seemed like the first pit stop we lost about 10 cars. Second pit stop we were able to claw back another 5 or 6. You were on the good side of all of those. It did seem like you were missing a couple of teammates towards the end there. But when you guys were working together, really trying to claw back this first couple of cars, you know, what were you really thinking? You know, you had about 5 or 6 laps to go and they were right in sight and you were pulling right up to them. Were you expecting to go straight to the outside to try to keep the momentum, or were you going to just kind of fall in line and see where it went?
Oh, I was going for that second groove anyway I could get it. So that was my line. I was going to stay there no matter what. So that's what I did.
Yeah, it really showed too. And I think D actually said, you know, I don't think he's going to get out of that second line because that's where he prefers. Obviously, going into that final turn, and when you unfortunately saw the 43 of Hensley kind of blow his motor there on the inside, you know, what were you thinking at that point? Were you really looking behind you and just saying, hey, I hope this guy stays with me? Or were you kind of, you know, aware that somebody was going to try something on you at that point, and it was every man for themselves?
Yeah, I guess it was every man for themselves, but, you know, I guess I would have had a better shot if those guys didn't blow up on the inside. Maybe could have got Berger to push me there, but who knows? But whenever they blew, I didn't know David blew up. All I seen was they got unhooked. So I knew Brody was going to try to go to the inside, and I was going to leave him that. But I was going to try to make it hard. But he went to the inside, and I just rode that outside, was hoping, you know, to get a little run back on the front stretch. And, man, when everybody else fanned out the four wide there, I was like, oh, this is good for me. And then I got turned there at the end, right before the line, and we made a little contact, and man, it was a heck of a finish. That was my favorite finish here at FTSR, and to be battling TJ, you know, Brody and David Bernard, man, that was awesome to finish like that.
Oh, it really was. It was a treat for everybody watching. And you know what? To lose, I can't even really say that you lost. I mean, you put on a hell of a show for everybody the entire night. All of our fans here at FTSR Racing, you know, they were able to watch one of the best finishes that they've ever seen. You know, margin of victory of 0.015. You know, if there's a way to lose, that's the best way to do it, if you will. And, you know, I congratulate you on every single thing you did. You played the strategy. You came back from 28th starting on the starting grid, finished second in one of the closest margin of victories in FTSR history. You know, Blackwater Motorsports, you guys did a great job all night. You know, I just want to leave the mic open for you to thank your sponsors, thank anybody you need to thank. And, you know, we really appreciate what you did. And you put on one hell of a race tonight, sir.
Yeah, I'd like to thank my wife for letting me do this, and you know, my kids and stuff. But I also like to thank Steve Berry for sponsoring us, and with Blackwater Products USA, go check them out. Please give them some support, and thank everybody here at the league, and you guys for doing the broadcast, man. You guys do such a great job, and I just love it here. So thank you.
Well, Dean, you know what? That was Casey McMullen, and I think he just made the second best move of the night and thanking his wife first, because all of us, let's face it, we thank our wives on a nightly basis, but I believe you're standing by with our winner, TJ Bartell.
Yeah, I got TJ Bartell tonight, the race winner here at the Talladega 200. TJ, congratulations, man. What an awesome finish.
Oh, thanks, guys. Yeah, that was... That was crazy. Kind of saw an opening and figured, what the heck, I'm still going to have a decent finish, and maybe those two guys will get bogged a little bit. I'll have a little momentum, and it just worked out.
Yeah, it wasn't just two guys. You had Schildhaus up top. But let's start back. Let's go back in the race a bit to the early parts of the race. You know, you were running up there, but you got to be thinking just, you know, pit stops and how you come out. So talk about the evolution of those first two stops. We've seen went pretty well on the first stop, second stop. You had like three or four different groups there for a little bit.
Yeah, we were kind of thinking, especially once the race had that kind of green field to it, we were already starting to think, you know, what do we want to do pit stop wise, and you know, planning for that. And we didn't want to be the first ones on pit road, and we didn't want to be the last ones on pit road, so we were just kind of like, you know, biding our time, trying to get each other get together in a group so that we could kind of go on there and then come off good. And it worked out pretty good as far as you know, we had pretty good pit stops and on and off pit road, and it gained us a lot of track position.
Yeah, we watched all the pit road entries. I mean, groups of 15 cars, other groups with 8 or 6 or whatever, but what a fantastic job. I don't think I've seen that many cars come down pit road together with no problem whatsoever. I mean, 4 wide at times going on to pit road clean. What a great job by the guys here at Full Throttle Sim Racing.
Yeah, everybody did a great job tonight. It was remarkably clean, and everybody kept their heads, and they did a good job overall. And, you know, because you're always on pins and needles when it comes time for that first pit stop, because you think the first group, you know, there's going to be a melee or whatever, and you're trying to plan for that. And, you know, do you want to beat them in? Do you want to wait? And so they went nice and smooth and green, and it was a good clean race. And, you know, we were just trying to run our race the way we wanted to, and just be smooth with our pit stops and try and gain track position that way, and it worked out.
Well, pretty much mirrors the broadcast. So, you know, smooth and just pit stops and just running nice. And then we come down to 2 to go, and things get a little crazy here, man. We're coming around with, well, I guess 1 to go. David Hensley, so unfortunate, but he blows his engine on the inside. You're looking at the time before that happened, you know, somewhere in the top 5 perhaps, and all of a sudden he blows his engine, and the whole track opens up. Brody darts down low. The track opens up. What were you thinking when Hensley blew his engine there?
Well, we were talking about it before that, me and Brody, because he was pushing Casey, and I figured, you know, we're just going to stay in line here and try and push Casey to the win, because I don't think that we could have, you know, driven outside him 3 wide and had any shot at the win. You know, I think we would have lost ground because the bottom lane was, you know, pretty hooked up, and they had a lot of good momentum. And then once David's engine let go, it's like that just killed that bottom line. So it just kind of opened everything up and kind of gave you options to try, let's say. And when Brody dove down to the bottom on the last part, he's like, just before he did that, he's like, if you see anything, you know, if you got an opening, go ahead, you know, and we'll see what we can do. And when he dropped to the bottom, I just took it to the high side and said, you know, I'm gonna have hopefully a top 5, maybe a top 10 finish if this doesn't work. And if it does work, maybe those two will stall each other out and I'll have a little bit of momentum, and that's what happened.
Yeah, boy, did it ever work out. You also had Schildhaus. I don't know if you were aware, but you were 4 wide coming to the line. Schildhaus maybe lost a little momentum right at the end there, but it was 4 wide coming to the line. And the three of you guys all hit each other. And you also had Ronnie Royal coming into the back end of both Brody and Casey. Just mayhem there at the end, man. I'm so pumped. That was the most exciting finish I've ever seen. And I couldn't be happier that you're the one that took it home, TJ. Wow. Congratulations, man.
Yeah, thanks, Dean. It's always great to win, and to win in really exciting wild finish like that is awesome. Just thank you guys for doing the broadcast. Thank Blackwater Products USA for sponsoring this series. Thank my team, Fury Motorsports. We all worked pretty well together this week, and it showed. Just a great bunch of racers at FTSR. It was a really good race tonight.
We might have to have Jared have you on the overdrive every week now, man, if this is the way it's going to go for you.
Yeah, maybe that's my good luck charm, man. You know, hey, I'll take it if it is.
All right, man. Congrats again. Brad, that's TJ Bartell, man, our race winner tonight.
And he did a great job. And you know what? Everybody really did a great job tonight. I mean, it was a very clean race. You know, a lot of it was to be expected, you know, a lot of follow the leader, kind of shuffle for position throughout the night, you know, make sure that you're in the race to be, you know, make sure you're going to be able to finish the race to be in the race at the end. But, you know, that, oh man, that the ending of that race, that last lap, you know, you couldn't have scripted any better. I mean, that was just, it was great.
It was just incredible. Now the points, looking at the points now, not a whole lot of change there. You're still going to have Bernard Persson in the lead. We've got 2 races left coming up. We've got Dover followed by Martinsville right here on Full Throttle TV, Brad. These are going to be great shows as well.
Oh man, talk about polar opposites, going from a big track like Talladega straight into Dover and then to Martinsville. I mean, you had guys tonight that, you know, they were able to just kind of put it wide open, just kind of drive around and kind of log their laps and do their time. There's not any of that. You don't get the log laps of Dover. You don't get the log laps of Martinsville. You have to be in total control and concentration, or you're going to end up in the wall at both of those tracks. You know, oh, man, that's going to be rough.
Going to be rough. Could shake things up. We'll have it live here Wednesday night at 9 o'clock with Blackwater Products USA Truck Series with Full Throttle Sim Racing. Man, I can't wait to get into it, man, and finish off this year. It's going to be a battle to the end. We got so many great drivers in this series. We got great people running it. And, you know, if you want to check something out, check out FullThrottleSimRacing.net. Or check us out on through iRacing, a great league, a bunch of you know, older, wiser people here like Green Flag Racing. But make no mistake about it, they're fast, and there's some hard nosers racing out here as well, Brad.
Yeah, and you know what? Also keep an eye out for a new podcast coming out by the makers of the FTR series, if you will. A lot of information on the FTR series as well as NASCAR races. That's going to be Overdrive.
Yeah, Overdrive looking good. We got Jared Carr doing some one-on-ones. He just had TJ Bartell in the booth this week. We also have like a five-man panel talking some NASCAR stuff and iRacing stuff. Great show there. Go check out Overdrive. You can find them on Facebook, and I'll try and get some more proper links to where else you can find the podcast. But for now, look up Overdrive on Facebook. Some great stuff there. But anyway, for tonight, man, out of breath, Brad, this was a fantastic finish. One of the best I've ever seen on iRacing. So exciting. Can't wait for next week, Wednesday night, 9 o'clock, right here. We'll be at Dover Motor Speedway. Until then, I'm Dean Doucette. That's Brad Patterson, and we'll see you next time.